So often this time of year, we'd just be chilling under some tent backstage, catching up with people. And if you folks have ever wondered what backstage conversation sounds like, how to eat all your squash before it ruins.
Yes, squash problems.
We're gonna have to write a tune called Squash Problems.
Yeah, that would be great.
On that note, why don't we play a couple more songs?
Let's do it.
I'm Sierra Holm. I have a very special guest with me today. She's one of the most talented people I know. She's an amazing guitarist, songwriter, singer, and she happens to be my sometimes bandmate and one of my dearest friends. Molly Tuttle's in the house.
Hello, everyone. It's so great to be here. Good to see you, Sierra.
You're literally in the house, and I'm in my house, and we've been spending a lot of time in our houses lately. How have you been holding up during all this?
I've been doing all right. I've been like coming up with different projects to keep myself occupied. I've been like starting some new hobbies and then giving up on them and starting a new hobby. I've found that quarantine really goes in phases for me. But I just came out with a record of covers that I recorded all in my home during quarantine. So that was fun. It was nice to have something to look forward to. But it's so strange now that that's out. I'm like, well, now what do I do? Normally you would like tour and promote stuff for a year, maybe more.
For us, we've had a tiny little garden. So a bunch of the storms blew through here in Nashville, like 2 weeks into quarantine, you know. Actually, well, a week before there was a tornado. As you know, you live in Nashville as
Right,
well, and
yes.
kind of blew through town and did a lot of damage, unfortunately. But we had tornadoes that hit, I don't know, a mile from our house, but we were extremely lucky and didn't have any damage. And then about 3 weeks later, another big storm with highline winds came through and completely knocked down our tree in our backyard and our front yard. So it just demolished our fence in the backyard. But
Oh,
where
man.
there's a silver lining, we had the fence had to be replaced, but we ended up cutting up part of the fence and making a raised bed vegetable garden.
Oh,
So
that's so
we've been growing
cool.
stuff over here.
Oh, nice. You reused your fence to grow a garden. That's so cool. What have you been growing?
Well, mostly tomatoes and peppers, onions, herbs, things like that. So just
That's
it's
so
pretty small.
nice.
We didn't dive in too hardcore because we thought, well, we'll just get our feet wet with it a little bit.
Yeah, that's a big project.
So that's been good. But yeah, it's an interesting time, I think, just trying to figure out how to stay creative. And I think that having this time for me has given me an opportunity to just dig back into some of the music I've always loved that isn't my own. And I think there's something cool about being able to take a break from ourselves during this period. And like
Yes.
for me, sitting around learning other people's music or working on things that I've always loved but never really felt like I had time to work on because I'm always so busy touring and playing my own music. So tell us a little bit about your cover project and how you came to choose some of these songs, because I feel like from what I know about it, it's sort of a similar story of just finding songs you've always loved.
Really similar. Yeah, it's funny that you say that because I felt like after the tornado and then right after the tornado, I flew out to LA and was talking to Tony Berg, who ended up producing the cover record that I did. But I flew back from his house because I was supposed to go on tour, and I got the call when I was out in LA that every show was canceled for the foreseeable future. And so I flew straight back to Nashville. And I remember it was so hard to leave town after the tornado. I wanted to stick around and help out, and just it was just a hard time to leave the community. So then I flew back, and it was like a double whammy of the quarantine. So that was really what this project was about, just kind of taking a break. I felt like I was struggling to find my own words and to process everything, and just kind of going back to these songs that that bring me so much joy, and that maybe some of them have helped me through hard times before. And so it was a really fun process. It was definitely not what I thought I'd be doing this year. And then kind of recording at my home, I had never even used Pro Tools, so I'm not like the most technologically advanced person. I always was using GarageBand to demo stuff. So I'd learned Pro Tools, and that was definitely something I wouldn't have done. I'm not like an expert at it, but I learned super basic stuff and recorded it all at my house. So that was a
Yeah.
whole process that I'd never done before, which was really interesting. And I was happy with how it worked out. I think working with Tony, who is such an experienced producer, was really helpful. I definitely trusted that he would make it all sound good, even if I was struggling to figure out how to use all the new recording gear that I'd never used before, but we kept it simple and
it turned out great.
Thanks.
Totally. Well, that being said, maybe we should dive in and at least let's play a song for the people. What do you say?
Let's do it.
Well, here's a song off my brand new cover record that came out a couple weeks ago. It's a collection of songs that I've loved throughout the years. And I recorded the whole record back in March right here in my house. I recorded my parts on my own and sent it off to other musicians who put parts on it from their home studios in quarantine. And this song in particular is one of my favorites. It's by the band Rancid. They're a Bay Area punk band. I grew up in Palo Alto, California, and listened to them a lot as a kid. And I rediscovered this song last fall when I was playing in Olympia, Washington. And the song is called Olympia, Washington. So I worked it up for the show, and then it became one of my favorites to play. So here it is. Olympia, Washington by Rancid. 1, 2, 3.
Thank you. any crazy quarantine stories?
Ooh, crazy quarantine stories. I don't know. Do you have any?
Oh,
I made you that squash quesadilla. That was kind of yes!
crazy. So here's the deal, people that are watching. You know how it is. It's garden season. And so, you know, for us, it's just interesting to have any food in our homes whatsoever, because as touring musicians, we're used to having no food in our homes because we're never home. I've had a lot of squash that's been given to me. So we have our little modest garden, but we haven't grown any squash of our own. But I'm from here in Tennessee. I grew up like 2 hours away from Nashville. My parents always have a big old garden with my Aunt Betty. And my husband's mom and dad always have a huge garden. So anytime we get to visit, they pile us on with the squash. And we always bring a huge bag home. And I think somebody maybe sent you a bunch of squash too during this time.
I signed up. So it was kind of a similar thing where I'm like, I'm home from tour. Like, I can finally do a CSA type thing where you get like veggies each week. And I was so excited because you like don't get to do stuff like that when you're touring all the time. So I signed up for one called Misfits Market, where they give you like kind of fruits and veggies that had something wrong with them and like the grocery stores rejected them. But every week it was like fruits and vegetables, and then there would be like two or three squash in the box too. And I just ended up with a pile of squash at the end, and I finally had to cancel it because I'm like, I have too much squash. I put one squash in my front yard and I'm like, maybe it'll compost, and it's been months and it's still sitting there. I don't really know how to compost. But then, yeah, so finally I cut up I had like three squash left, and I cut them up and baked them, but then they were just in my fridge. So I've been like trying to sneak them. I call it like the daily squash I have to eat.
Just put them into all kinds of stuff. Well, that's the thing. It's like, what is it about squash? I feel like people always grow 10 times more squash than anything else.
Yeah.
But most, it's kind of like fourth or fifth on the list of favorite vegetables for most people. But everybody just grows way more squash than anything else. So then you can't get rid of it fast enough. You can't give it away. You can't eat it fast enough.
You really can't.
Yeah, totally.
Here's one that I wrote with my friend Steve Pultz a couple summers ago, and I love playing this with Sierra. We get to do it whenever we do a duo set. And I don't really play this one in my own set, so it's always a treat to get to play this one together. It's called 4th of July. 1, 2, 3.
Spell of your wandering eyes, and I believe in heaven now, it's true. I can hear the angels sing for you, and all I know is the feeling when it's right. I'll meet you out. You out for the fireworks tonight. stitches all look seamless on the 4th of July. You spark my heart just like a box of matches, and I love to lay beside you in the glow of the light. I believe in heaven, now it's true.
Love playing music with you, and it's really fun to get to collaborate like this. I will say, I mentioned at the beginning that my sometimes bandmate, and we do get to play together. We've played together a little bit as a duo anyway, but we also get to collaborate in the First Ladies of Bluegrass with Allison Brown and Missy Raines and Becky Bowler, and we've got to do a handful of shows like that as well. But our history together goes way back, maybe further than some people might realize. We first met when we were about 12 years old. I guess we were both invited to do the Kids on Bluegrass show at IBMA. I remember meeting you back then, and you were already shredding on guitar. And that was one of the cool things about getting to go to IBMA, because I met a lot of people that I've continued to have these relationships with. And so it's been cool. We sort of had this large gap of time where we didn't see each other and didn't get to hang out. And then all of a sudden, you moved to Nashville. Well, I guess actually I'll back up and say I went to Berkeley and I spent 2 years doing a program there. You went to Berkeley, but we kind of overlapped the times that we were in Boston. So I think I was leaving right as you were coming in.
Yeah, you left just as I came in, and I did that. We did the same program, though. I was there for that 2 year kind of artist diploma, I think it's called. But we just missed each other, and then I ended up here.
Exactly. And then, of course, you moved to Nashville, and I don't remember like where we would have first connected after you moved to Nashville. It might have even been recording on our friend Missy Rain's project together. But like, definitely we've been in the same community as we've gotten older, to think back about being our little 12-year-old selves. And
I know. And now, it's so
cute. And now here we are, both living in Nashville and getting to collaborate on some really fun projects together.
Yeah. I remember like growing up, I just didn't see that many other kids playing bluegrass. And then I went out to IBMA and met you and so many other kids who were just so amazing. And I was like, wow, I want to like hang out with these kids all the time and jam. But I lived in California and far away from everyone else. But and then moving here, I remember we just kept getting called in for the same sessions, and we were getting paired up a lot for things, which was super fun. Like, finally get to play with you so much.
Yeah, totally.
One, two, three, four.
Poison, you are poison to me. Oh, true apothecary, stole my sanctuary, kissed my creation with your lips of poison. Stole my
sanctuary, kiss to my creation with your lips of poison. Your drugs are quick, but my mind is quicker. This I won't let it die, but it might get sicker by your poison. Toxic mixture in the end. Oh, with your poison, you are poison to me. Oh, true apothecary, stole my sanctuary, kissed my creation with your lips of.
You grew up in California, and a lot of folks may not realize, but California has a really great bluegrass scene, and there's a lot of great musicians, and I know your dad is a musician, so just tell everybody a little bit about how you started playing guitar and what kind of drew you to all this to begin with.
Yeah, so my dad grew up playing bluegrass. He grew up on a farm in Illinois, and my grandfather, his dad, was a banjo player, and he loved Earl Scruggs and Bill Monroe. And so my dad grew up playing bluegrass with his dad. And then he moved out to California after college. I think he was kind of drawn to the Bay Area because that was the time when David Grisman was there and Mike Marshall and all this really cool, more like progressive bluegrass was happening in California. So that kind of drew my dad out there. And he didn't plan on being a musician really, but he ended up teaching music. So teaching private lessons and group classes, and he has bluegrass jam classes, and he's really helped in Palo Alto. There's so many bluegrass musicians who take lessons or have taken lessons from my dad. He's taught there for so long. But yeah, there's a really great scene. I remember seeing like Lori Lewis and Kathy Kalick playing all over the Bay Area. They both are based there, and they were really wonderful mentors to me when I was a kid. And I was just going through, there's a California Bluegrass Association newsletter that they just stopped printing it, but I got the last one a couple months ago, and I was just looking through it last night, and they have like a full page of bluegrass jams around the Bay Area, and there's so many. It's such a big scene, and there's little workshops and square dances and bluegrass festivals, and I was just looking through the list, and I was like, wow, it was really cool. People don't think of California as like the bluegrass hub, but there is such a scene for it there, which is really cool.
Totally. Well, you mentioned Lori Lewis, and then of course, you know, with Grisman being out there for so long and making waves, and of course Tony Rice was out there with him for a while, doing stuff. And then you have people like Stuart Duncan, you know, one of my favorite fiddle players of all time, and Allison Brown, our bandmate in the First Ladies, and Rob Ikes. I mean, the list kind of goes on and on. And I think sometimes people don't realize how much California has really meant to, you know, the music that kind of we put our roots down in, you know? So I love that.
Right. It's really interesting how it made its way out there, and it's a whole scene out there.
Totally. Well, how about we play, let's play a tune, you know, talking about going back to those IBMA days. We both grew up playing this tune with our brothers, and we were just recently kind of bonding over the fact that when we learned to play harmony on our instruments, it was so exciting to play a tune that had harmony in it. So this is a standard tune that we both would have jammed thousands of times over the years at bluegrass jams, yes, like that very one. Me here in Tennessee, you in California. And that's kind of the beauty is mm-hmm. that when we would have first met all those years ago, we would have both known this tune and been able to jam on tunes just like this for hours. So let's play Salt Creek.
Yeah, let's do it.
I love playing those old tunes. That's a super fun one.
Yeah.
I know we played that together at the Telluride Bluegrass Festival when we did a late night showcase with our bands. We got to mm-hmm. do a late night set together and played Salt Creek as a duo. And I don't know, that some of those tunes like that, you just don't get tired of playing, you know, they're just,
I know,
they kind of feel nostalgic. They stay with you for a lifetime, and I love that.
Yeah, really nostalgic when you learn them at such a young age. You can kind of just come, they're comforting to play over and over again with people.
Totally. It's sort of like, in some ways, they're kind of like breathing because they're just so familiar mm-hmm. that
yeah.
you don't ever forget a tune like Salt Creek. But also, to play them well takes a lot of facility. So, like, if you haven't been doing it in a while, sometimes I'm like, ooh, I gotta get back on it.
Oh, me too. It's funny how you can forget like little details of them and be like, oh, that last phrase, like, how did that actually go? Or, and you can just always be coming up with new ways to play them too, which makes them fun forever.
Yeah. And I feel like to really be good at doing it, you kind of have to keep your chops up because it can get yeah. away from you quickly.
Yeah, it can get away pretty fast.
It always comes back, but you sort of have to circle back around to them every now and then. So it's always fun to revisit those, because I don't feel like I get to nearly enough, you know, in sort of normal everyday life as we're playing. You know, I know when you're touring, you're mostly playing a lot of original music since you write so much of your own music, and I write most of my music too. So it's like, you know, being able to go back to those tunes like that is just always a little bit of a breath of fresh air.
It is, yeah. And I remember, like, before I started touring so much with my own band, I would go to bluegrass all the time, but now I don't go to any at all because there aren't any really, but yeah.
Don't go like anywhere at all.
You end up playing your own tune, so it's really nice to come back to those ones and get that feeling of being at a jam.
Totally. Well, I'm a big fan.
Yeah, that was a little over a year ago. It came out 2019 in April.
Yeah, so tell us a little bit about that project, and maybe we'll even play something off that.
Yeah, it was really my first full-length record of my own originals. I had come out with an EP a few years ago that was all, I guess my EP in a way felt like my first album, even though it was shorter than a normal album, but it was all the songs I'd kind of been building up throughout my life to record. And then this one was the follow-up to that. And it was a fuller collection of songs. It was mostly stuff I'd written after moving to Nashville. I'd like dipped my toes into co-writing for the first time. And so I wrote some of those with other people in town, wrote some on my own, and worked with Ryan Hewitt, he produced it and mixed it and engineered it, and he was really great to work with. But it was exciting. It was an exciting project, and it felt really like something I'd been building up to for a long time.
And you, one of my favorite songs, which I think we're going to do, is called Take the Journey. And you use this claw hammer guitar style, which is pretty unique. I mean, I know you learned it from a friend in California, but it's not something you see very often, and you do it so incredibly well. Tell us a little bit about like how you got into that, because I think people, if they see you do this, are always like, whoa, and it's really just like a cool thing.
Thanks. Yeah, that style is it's derived from the banjo, clawhammer banjo style of playing. And when I was 13 or 14, I learned to play clawhammer banjo, and I was getting more into old time music, and I was listening to like people like Ola Bell Reed and Roscoe Holcomb, but also like Gillian Welch. And I wanted to learn her songs where she was playing clawhammer banjo. So I started learning that style on the banjo. And then I was teaching at a music camp when I was a little older. And I saw on the schedule, this guy, Michael Stadler, was teaching a clawhammer guitar workshop. So I went to that, and he showed everyone this tuning that's similar to the banjo tuning. It's like a modal G tuning, and just taught us a simple tune using the style on guitar. And it's really just the same thing transferred over to guitar, but since the gauges of strings are different and you have like the low strings on the bottom, whereas banjo you have a high droney string on the top, on the bottom, it just is a different sound. And it's, people sometimes say it sound or it looks like I'm playing like slap bass, but I think it's actually like the opposite of slap bass in a way. The style is like, yeah.
Is that because you're hitting more inward than pulling out with the string?
Yeah. I don't know much about slap bass, but someone showed it to me, like your
nor
thumb
do I.
Hitting up and your fingers are going down, and then clawhammer guitar is like fingers down and then I don't know. It's hard to explain, but it's a little counterintuitive. But yeah, there's a handful of people I know out in the Bay Area who play that style, but really not too many people around are doing it. I've seen some videos of people learning Take the Journey, actually, and learning the clawhammer guitar, which I think is really fun.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, let's do that too.
Yeah, let's do it.
End. Lonely hearts cry without warning when the light. fall. Days of drought will nearly starve you. There's no use hiding, gotta face it all. Take the journey, no matter where it starts or where it ends. Take the journey, someday you'll make it back home again. Skies are falling all around you. Who will protect you in your deepest fears? Take the hand of the one beside you. Let the fire guide you till the path is clear. Take the journey, no matter where it starts, where it ends. Take the journey, someday you'll make it back home again. Someday you'll make it back home.
I know there's a lot of people that are out here watching this right now that have been probably on the emotional roller coaster that we've all been on. I was talking to a friend of mine earlier this morning, and I was just like, some days I just feel like I'm kind of going crazy, and then other days, like, I feel really happy and peaceful that I have this time mm-hmm. off the road and this yeah. time at home. How do you see yourself navigating that on a daily basis right now?
Yeah, I think it's definitely a struggle because, like you said, like, I have so many things where I'm like, I want to be able to learn this and, like, do this and write all these songs and, like, work on another record. But I think it is such a weird time. So you have to remember, like, to cut yourself some slack with that, too. Like, we're all trying to process this huge shift in our lives while trying to pursue these creative ideas. And I think maybe just, like, setting aside time each day to be creative, but not putting the extra pressure on it of like, I have to do this, and kind of letting the seeds sow themselves. It's almost like how you grew a garden, like you're kind of growing a creative garden right now. And I think at the end, we're all going to have a lot to look back on and say, oh, I was really proud of myself for how I handled this whole situation, or proud of this thing that I did. But it is hard when you have an endless stretch of days. You can feel like they're just going by, or at least I do sometimes. I feel like they're going by, and it's, I have to remember to look back and say, oh, well, I did this. I did record this album. I did this thing that was good that day. And even though I don't feel great every day, it's not like,
like what's true
can be grateful yeah. for.
You know, you just have to keep putting one foot in front of the other and trying to be grateful for all the things we have to be grateful for. And I think we'll all be better on the other side of all this in the end, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah. And we're all going through it together.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's worth mentioning there are a lot of people that are struggling right now. And one of the wonderful things that I think is great about Hang In and Hang Out is that we're bringing awareness to the Sweet Relief Musicians Fund. And mm-hmm. they've worked wonderful things in the lives of musicians during these crazy times, helping people in need, and have really been a huge part of the COVID relief that a lot of musicians have been given during this time. So I hope folks will donate to them, check out the cause. You can go to sweetrelief.org for more information. And yeah, it's been a pleasure to get to hang out with you virtually today,
you
Molly.
Too. Yeah, it's so great to see you again and catch up.
I know. And I always love making music with you. And for everybody that's been watching this, we appreciate you guys tuning in. Go check out Molly's latest album that just came out. So great. And all of her albums for that matter. But I'd Rather Be With You is the name of it. And hopefully we'll get to play music again soon in person, but I'm glad we got to collaborate this way. And enjoy
for having
the rest of your time, and all the best with all the creative up and downs of of 2020.
Yeah, you too. I can't wait to hear what you're working on. Thanks for having me as a guest.
Gosh, my pleasure. And thanks everybody for tuning in. We'll see you next time.
Yeah, thanks you guys.
Thanks, Molly. See ya.
If
anybody wants to hear about squash,
they'll edit it all.
Makes me laugh. Yeah, they'll be like, none of that. Oh, you should do B-roll of your squash.